video conference was something that was super high technology. And today, it's just click, right? And most of the time it works, so this is pretty good. These are three economic developers making this happen, not three Cisco engineers or anything. So that's really good. So on the screen, we have let me back up before I do that. I just want to say that the goal for community broadband people is to never have to talk about broadband. Like, we don't talk about electricity. Man, I went home and my electricity worked really good last night. I could plug in all my devices, my toaster, my toaster oven. Right? It's just supposed to be invisible. Just part of the fabric of our communities. And that's now the way it is in both Red Wing and Bemidji. They've got fiber to the home networks. They've got it's been there for a while. Last summer, Ann Tracy and I did some work on five rural communities case studies. And these are the two top ones as far as both Ann and I are concerned, but of people really making use of technology and integrating that into their economic development strategies. And let me make sure that's not Mila calling me. Nope, that's good. So they just are working, and we talked this morning briefly about this intelligent community approach, the idea of, broadband infrastructure and knowledge workers and innovation, digital inclusion, and marketing. That's what's known as the intelligent community approach, the five pillars of that. And both Bemidji and Red Wing are working on those pillars to improve the tech vitality and the overall community vitality. And so today we have Dave Hengel, who's an old pal of mine from way back, and for many years, Dave has been working in economic development in first in the Headwaters region, and then with the City of Bemidji nonprofit group called Bemidji something or other, right?
Greater Bemidji,
thank you. And, one of the great things about the Bemidji area is the length of time that the economic development effort has been in place. And so Dave's organization now is probably 25 or 30 years old, with probably two directors in that whole time. And so that they say overnight success in economic development, takes a decade. And I think that that leadership effort over a long period of time is critical. So welcome, Dave.
Thank you, Bill. Thanks for having me.
And also with us is Nino Mulgard, who's with Red Wing Ignite, which is a nonprofit organization aimed really at driving innovation in Red Wing. And we've worked very closely with Red Wing as a land and broadband community. Dave so far has resisted the call. They just go out, Bemidji has their own deal. Just leave them alone and they go crazy.
Just keep bugging me, Bill.
I keep bugging you. Well, when you look good, then I look good. So that's how what I like about it. So,
all right.
But the Red Wing has got a great deal of momentum trying to improve their economy. And these are two great examples of rural Minnesota communities that I think really have it going on. They've got business growth and population growth. And if you pay attention, Bemidji wins everything now. They're the best of this and the best of that. It's amazing. The honors keep coming in. And a lot of that, as you get to that intelligent community approach, is the idea of marketing, positioning your community as a place for to live and work and invest. So we're going to have a little conversation here today framed by that intelligent community approach. And we're going to start off with Nila. Let's talk about workforce development and attraction. What is going on in Red Wing around the workforce?
Yeah, hello everyone. Thanks for including me in today. We have put a lot of efforts in not only inside but outside of the classroom. to help students. So one thing is we brought tech entrepreneur programs, international programs, best practices to our area. So we've had a tech entrepreneur program. We've had a Coder Dojo, which is an international program. We've started our third annual college tech internship, where we work with local and regional colleges and regional businesses to match the skills needed and help with that talent pipeline. We're also doing a new initiative with Youth Skills Training, working with six different school districts and local businesses to try to get experiential learning with 16, 17-year-old students. And we're also planning a makerspace, just a soft launch around the corner at our local Minnesota State College Southeast location, and that will be for students, for our community, and our businesses.
Neela, can you talk a little bit about that success story with your young woman who was the webmaster for your company, where she started kind of a whole new e-commerce line as an intern, where she'd come in and done all the...
We've really seen a great benefit with our college internships. We've had, for the last 2 years, we've had a total of 5 interns, and almost all of them have stayed on in some capacity at the work site. So we had one woman who helped a company with their whole e-commerce platform, and the business estimates that they saved almost $100,000 with her help versus having to do that on their own. Another organization, we helped the county, they needed a system to check out vehicles. And in our markets, they're not having a lot of cars, and it's a little bit bigger than something that you could use an Excel sheet for. So one of our software developers, this intern was a software developer, made an entire new system for the county to use, which they still use today. And the beginning software for that would have been easily $20,000. That they did not need to spend.
Thanks, Neela. Dave, how about in Bemidji? You have a 4-year college there, and what are you doing about workforce?
Well, we have a 4-year college and a 2-year college in Northwest Tech, but I've been doing economic development for 30 years, and you start seeing 10 years ago the trend where really economic development is becoming a race for talent more than it is a race for companies. Because companies are going to go where the people are. And so we've spent a lot of time focusing on workforce development, talent retention, and recruitment. And a lot of our efforts focus on that. So a couple things that are a little bit unique for us. So I'm in a 501c3 economic development organization. We actually have a training center under our economic development organization. I think it's probably the only one that I can think of, at least in the state, that has its own training center under its own economic development umbrella, and that's intentional. We're trying to meet the needs of our companies, specifically for short-term and certificate-based training. And that's being done in partnership with Bemidji State and Northwest Tech and in Bemidji. And so that's one. We also recently, 2 years ago, in partnership with the high school, created these career academies for our high school students. But we've taken, at this point, 10 different careers of high need, IT being one of them, in our region, and are helping our students as early as 8th and 9th grade, starting to get a taste of what the career means, directed curriculum, industry experiences, opportunities to job shadow, opportunities for summer employment, things like that. We're all intentionally trying to help our students go into a direction of need in the region and opportunity for them in the region as well. So we spend a lot of time. We spend a lot of time focused on workforce development and talent creation.
Okay, thank you. Neela, talk about new companies and innovation. And that's one of the prime focuses of Red Wing Ignite. Want to talk about what you're doing to spur new business formation?
Of course. So we have a business accelerator here. And what our main goal or our main function with that is getting the resources that entrepreneurs and emerging businesses need to succeed. So we link them to mentors, to investors, to customers, to technical advisors. One thing that we've really seen with that customer base, being a smaller town, able to give that real life I call it a microcosm of the real world. So they can talk to some of the key stakeholders and learn that their business might need to pivot. You know, if you talk to your customer and they're not thrilled, you know, you need to pivot quickly. So that is what we do. We've recently launched a new angel fund, and we're always looking for new tools for our toolbox to be able to support new businesses.
You have a lot of mentorship going on too between existing companies and new companies, is that right?
Yes, and then another new initiative is Ignite Minnesota. We applied and received a designation from US Ignite and the National Science Foundation to be the statewide hub for their initiative, which really expands our efforts and our networks for even greater connectivity in greater Minnesota, and then with links nationally.
Okay, so this group here can find out more about that program on the Red Wing Ignite website, is that right?
Yes, and more information to come. We just launched that initiative at the end of February. We're still producing more information for everyone.
Okay, good.
Engaged.
Dave, how about you with new company formation?
That's a priority. Working with entrepreneurs is a priority for us. We have a unique group of young millennials in Bemidji that have started to emerge and started to create companies. And about 5 years ago, they led us in creating what we call a launch pad. We've taken a 1901 building, remodeled an old brick warehouse into what we would consider a one-stop shop, not all that different from what Neil was talking about in Red Wing, which is an attempt to bring all those resources that you might need to start your own company right here in one space. And so it includes co-working space. We have, I think it's 53 members today that use the space to start or operate their company. We have free business consulting. We too have retired CEOs in Bemidji. We have a lot of retired folks that are live here in the summer out on the lakes and have taken their time, pretty important CEOs, have taken their time to voluntarily mentor our young entrepreneurs. We do a weekly meetup as well, which every Wednesday morning at 8 o'clock, the entrepreneurs come together. There's usually 30 to 50. Yesterday was our third anniversary of doing that. We got 120 different entrepreneurs over the last 3 years present at our weekly meetups. It's quite incredible when you have these young entrepreneurs driving the agenda of the community, and really that's what's happening here, and it's pretty exciting to see. In fact, yesterday NPR was here interviewing some of them in a piece they call The Creative Economy in Rural Communities, and so listen for that as well. The other thing I'll just mention, Bill, is that we just published online what we call 123 Startup, which is trying to make the process of starting a company easier, from ideation and all the business planning, but also the permitting and the licensing we can now do online. And my organization then makes a commitment to each of them that you will have a navigator. One of us will work with you hand in hand as you work through the process all the way to startup.
Okay, good, thank you. I know both of your communities have great networks, gigabit services in your communities, so on, but affordability and digital inclusion is a big issue in every community. Dave, what is your community doing to try and make sure that everyone can connect to the internet and have the skills and so on?
Well, we're a little bit blessed, of course, is we have Paul Bunyan Communications, who's a local telco. Cooperative, used to be a telco cooperative, now is a communications cooperative that is providing our gigabit network to their entire region, which I believe is 6,000 miles worth. And so it's quite incredible, the all-fiber network they put in place. And the price is extremely reasonable because they're a co-op. They're there for their members, they're not there to make a major profit. And so just the fact that a co-op is willing to step up and do it, take the risk at a price that's very, very reasonable is huge, quite frankly. For us, particularly for younger entrepreneurs, we did create the Launchpad. Paul Bunyan provides the gigabit broadband within the Launchpad for free. And so they are running that through our facility, intentionally to try and provide access to people who simply wouldn't be able to do it on their own.
Okay, thanks. Neela?
Yep.
gigabit broadband provided by HBC, high broadband communication, and other carriers. But HBC's the heart of their system. Their gigabit system is in our basement here in our co-working facility, the Ignite building. We have done some efforts of digital inclusion, not our focus, but as being a Blandon broadband community and the partnership with PCs for People, that was a really fabulous opportunity for our community to be able to give out computers to so many families that met those qualifications. So that was a real asset. The schools, we did do some surveys through our STEAM advisor to learn about the connectivity at some of the homes as they were contemplating a one-to-one device. Interviewing teenagers, we don't know the quality of the data that we received or that it was a school survey. But the one-to-one device, still we don't push the one-to-one device at our schools unless there is curriculum with that and professional development with that and a whole host of other things. We're not promoting the device just to get a device.
Okay, thank you.
You know, Bill, just an added comment. You know, part of digital inclusion is also about the skills to use the technology and the data. I know Nilo mentioned some of the things we're doing at Red Wing. We're doing here too, things like coding camps, hack fests. Paul Bunyan sponsored what they call the GigaZone Gaming Championship, which is literally gaming, but it brings in about 2,000 people to watch people game and championship gaming. All those are intentional just to try and create the skills and develop the skills locally to take advantage of the broadband we do have available.
Great. And that certainly leads into marketing. The community is a place for technology, and that gaming championship is something that I know is big in Bemidji now. It's been held a couple years, and $10,000 in prize money or something like that. Talk about that Bemidji aura now that is seeming to emerge.
Well, it's interesting. Yeah, good point. We have had a pretty good year in terms of publicity, and some of it's done walking, of course, which is great, and some of it's hard work. Over 10 years of effort to try and position the community. But, you know, what I like to say is Bemidji's got a bit of a perceptional problem. Most people who have experience with Bemidji came up here with their families when they were young and remember a small resort town that's up in the Northwoods. Well, now we're a town of 50,000 people. We're a emerging regional center. A lot of business and job growth, pretty substantial. And so we've got this perceptional problem that I've got to handle and deal with. And so a lot of what we do is trying to help people understand what might surprise you about Bemidji and the things available. The broadband is one example of that. So we do quite a bit of co-marketing with Paul Bunyan and others to share the fact that we have perhaps the largest all-fiber broadband network in the nation and what that might mean. And again, that's just one of the things that might surprise people about this community. And so we spend an awful lot of time trying to break that image, of that old image of Bemidji. Not that it was a bad image, it simply isn't an accurate image anymore. And so we spent a lot of time promoting that and developing our town to really overcome some of those previous perceptions of the Northwoods.
Great. Dave, would you just take a minute and talk about your leadership council that meets so regularly?
Yeah, you know, back in, it's approaching 15 years ago, we had a group of communities, we call them stewards, come together. At the time, 25 of us came together and created what we call Bemidji Leads. And it was an all-volunteer group and still is. It's never had a budget, it's never had a staff person. It's just a bunch of community citizens that decide to come together and try and drive the agenda in the community and move the community forward. And 15 years ago, Bemidji was not the town it is today. But we put together a very bold agenda that we're still paying, that laid a foundation that has quite frankly, put us in a position of a window of opportunity that is outstanding. And they've been meeting once a month for close to 15 years now. They meet at 7 a.m. Once a month for 15 years. It used to be twice a month, and I finally convinced them maybe they didn't need to do that anymore. But your comment earlier about persistence and stick to it and keep battling, nothing nothing comes easy. The easy stuff's already been done. And so now you gotta kind of work hard and stick with it.
Okay. Thanks, Dave.
Yep.
Neela, talk about Red Wing Marketing.
Yeah, I'm always just so impressed to hear Dave, though. He's doing such great things there. The market, I guess our main way that we've marketed it is really through collaboration and partnering with other communities. And obviously we have some local initiatives with all of our ED committees meeting down on Main Street and the BCB and the Chamber and our economic development agencies, you know, some of those local collaborations like everyone has. But what I found in the work in the last few years is you can't do this work alone. And so it's really the convening and working with government, with academia, with businesses, and the community to have that greater impact in with entrepreneurs and students and businesses. So that is where I think for our organization, we spent most of the time on marketing is building those partnerships and building those collaborations between multiple cities, state, and the nation.
Neela, can you follow up a little bit with your partnership around the Minnesota Cup?
Yes, Blandin, thanks sponsorship with that. Blandin has been an amazing partner. So I do highly recommend being a Blandin Broadband Community Day.
Now I've got to come at you from all sides.
Blandin has been an incredible resource for our community, and we've had many, many positive outcomes of that process. But the Ignite Cup is next Wednesday. We are hosting, it's for Southern Minnesota, a startup competition. We're an automatic feeder then to the Min Cup competition, which is the largest statewide venture out of the University of Minnesota. And so we'll have a handful of pitches, and then the judges, whoever wins the Ignite Cup, will be an automatic semifinalist in the Min Cup competition, which really is an advantage considering they get thousands and thousands of applications. So that is a nice arrangement. We've done that with partnered with Mayo Clinic Business Accelerator, the Southern Minnesota Initiative Foundation, Deed, Blandin, and I hope I'm not forgetting someone else really obvious.
Good. Thanks so much there. Are there any questions from the audience? So I think one of the things I'd like to say about Bemidji, and Dr. James Benson is a big, quite a leader, extraordinary Minnesota, who's been active in Bemidji for many years. He talks about planning from the future,
right,
as opposed to for the future. Dave, do you have a minute on that?
Yeah, it's just, you know, he talks about, and Jim's an amazing man, and I suspect many of you may have actually met him over his career. He used to be the university president here and has stuck with us. Prior to that, he was at Dunwoody, just a wonderful guy, a tremendous steward of the community. And he talks about planning for the future, and he used John Kennedy's analogy that we're going to land on the moon this decade, for those who remember that point that he said. He didn't say, you know, we're going to study it, we're going to look at it, we're going to, you know, we'll take, we'll put an action plan together. He said, we're going to do it. And then it was up to the engineers at NASA to figure out how to get there from there. And that's really a critical thing for communities. You gotta decide who you wanna be when you grow up. Lay your stake out there 10 years or 15 years and then figure it out from there, not to there. Because if you do it to there, you mean it to there. And so I think I love his analogy. I love how he puts it, which is simply you gotta plan from the future, not to it.
Okay. Thank you so much.
You bet.
Neela, any closing remarks?
Well, I did hear something interesting. We had the National U.S. Ignite Conference last week in Kansas City, and it was in conjunction with the Smart Cities Conference. And it was hosted in Kansas City, so the mayor did some opening statements, and he said, similar to some of your comments, Bill, when you were opening this session, our next generation is not going to be talking about smart cities or gigabit cities or broadband. They're going to expect it. Just like they're not talking about our electricity right now, right? So he said, really, what we're gonna see if cities don't plan from the future, as Dave just said, that it's gonna be the the digital Rust Belt. And because our next generation is going to expect it. They're going to expect this kind of connectivity. They're going to expect this kind of innovation. And so those cities that don't will not see that growth. And he believes, but as he shared, it will be the digital Rust Belt.
Good. Thank you so much. Dave, anything before we go?
Well, just thankful, and thanks, Bill, for you and for Blandon. They would certainly have a massive impact on us. So to suggest that, I want to make sure you understand that they may not be a Blandon broadband community, but they certainly have an influence. And Bill and I have known each other a very long time, and served a career, and so it's great to be able to just visit with people about what's going on in different parts of the state.
Good, we appreciate that. I'd like to give everyone a hand here. You know, yesterday was the 50th anniversary of Martin Luther King's death, and I heard a replay of the dedication of the memorial. It's really interesting that President Obama at that time was talking about, you know, here's Martin Luther King, just a pastor of one small church in one city, and took on that leadership and had that vision. And that's really, you know, what the people in this room need to do. If you have a vision for great broadband in this region, you know, you don't need people with titles. You just need people with the vision and the energy. So I think both Dave and Neela have that kind of vision, are real leaders in their community, but have coalesced a group of leaders around them to really help them get the work done that they do so well. And that's why we have, you know, I think they're extraordinary communities. So I encourage you to go out there and do that work in your communities. And I think after the break, then, we're going to have a process to help come up with some of those strategies for doing that. So, Nicole, do you have any setting up remarks? Okay.
All right, there, you guys can hear me all right. So I have the pleasure of introducing one of our newest staff members, Christian Brecken, as part of our onboarding experience at Region 9. I like to make all new employees have to come up and talk to a group of 85 to just see how they do. And we've already invested in getting the shirt, so I hope he's going to do okay with a really special announcement here. But as he works his way up, I think to continue this afternoon, the last few hours of the day, keep thinking about what you can do and what you can do with your community. Because now is really brainstorming and thinking about what special leadership and what kind of actions we can take on to kind of build up what Bill was saying. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to Christian, our new senior regional planner, for a special announcement.
Hi, everyone. Thanks to Bill and Neela and Dave for a very, very interesting discussion. I've been waiting all day to make this announcement. It's probably the most important announcement you will hear today. And this announcement will be quick, but right now it's time for coffee and cookies out in the atrium. We won't call you back at 2:30.